Hey everyone, B Grimm here. So, I did a review probably back in like August or September for American Horror Story Season 1, Murder House. And I was supposed to do a review for Season 2, and I never did. And so I'm gonna do that now. yeah. I don't think I meant to put it off quite so long, but I did. So, without further ado, American Horror Story Season 2, Asylum. With spoilers. Okay, to begin with, Asylum is insane. American Horror Story Season 1, Murder House, was a pretty straightforward haunted house. Not really a lot of frills, not really a lot of extra stuff going on. There was kind of a hint at the end of like some sort of like apocalyptic coming of the end of times thing, but it was just kind of a hint. By and large, it was strictly the haunted house. Season 2 was a bit more ambitious, or maybe just plain insane. In no particular order, we have a serial killer, demonic possession, a early 60s to late 70s or early 70s mental hospital, alien abduction, death angel. Creepy Nazi doctor performing Frankenstein-esque experiments on patients. Yeah, there was just a lot going on in this particular season. So, quick run through of what's going on, who the characters are, blah, 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 blah. So, season opens with Evan Peters' character of Kit Walker, one of my favorites, certainly my favorite of that season. Okay, tied with Lana Banana, but Kit Walker is secretly married to a black woman in the early 1960s in the US. Yeah, that had to have sucked, by the way. People are assholes about interracial marriages now. Yeah, I can't imagine what it was like in the 60s. I'm not really sure I want to. I mean, I can't imagine. I really don't want to, though, because it's like it's bad now. God only knows what it was like back then. There's a bright flash of light, and suddenly we're in Briarcliff. Briarcliff, by the way, is the mental hospital here. It's being run by Saint Jude, played by Jessica Langley. Mentally, I'm singing "Hey Jude," because that's just kind of what I do. And she is being interviewed by Lana Winters, Lana Banana. Played by Sarah Paulson, who is a reporter trying to make it big, who wants desperately to interview the infamous serial killer Bloody Face, who supposedly is being brought to Briarcliff. Apparently, Kit Walker's Bloody Face. Or maybe not, but so far evidence appears to be pointing to yes. Lana Banana ends up being interred, I believe that's the correct word. Imprisoned in the asylum because it just so happens that Lana Banana is a lesbian. And Sister Jude pressures her partner, who is a school teacher, to sign a paper releasing Lana to their care. So, fun. Both Lana and Kit are under the care, partially, of Dr. Oliver Thredson, played by Zachary Quinto. Also working in the asylum is Lily Rabe's character of Sister Mary Eunice. The doctor, of course, is Dr. Arden, played by, I'm not actually sure, James Cromwell. Dr. Arden is a former Nazi who came to America. God only knows how. And working at Briarcliff is experimenting on the patients. A true Dr. Frankenstein. This becomes relevant later. This is just... I'm not quite sure how anyone could ever call Asylum their favorite season. It's not a bad season. There's just a lot going on. So, one of the patients is apparently possessed by a devil, a demon. And during an exorcism, Sister Mary Eunice becomes possessed. She goes from being this sweet, helpful, innocent, kind, shy, insert positive adjective here, to being, well, the devil, basically. Dr. Arden has a thing for Sister Mary Eunice. He's not pleased. No one is particularly pleased, but no one actually quite knows what's going on. Lana is attempting to undergo conversion therapy. It's not working, by the way. It's not going to. Conversion therapy is this bizarre thought that you can stop a person from being homosexual. There's one really big problem with conversion therapy. It doesn't work. It's essentially torture. It is torture. Often state sanctioned. So yeah. Not something I'm particularly thrilled to think about, but... So anyway, she's attempting to undergo conversion therapy so she can get out of the asylum. Kit Walker, meanwhile, is trying to prove his innocence. He has no idea what happened to his wife Alma or those other women. They're telling him he killed them, but he doesn't remember anything like this, and he kind of thinks he would. He has also kind of, believing his wife to be dead. He kind of takes up with another patient, supposed murderer, Grace, played by Lizzie, I'm not sure how to pronounce that, Brochere? I really wish the Mother of Monsters was here because I cannot speak, because that is a very French ending and I do not speak French. So we're just going to go with Brochere and hope that's correct. They attempt to escape. Doesn't go very well. One of the other patients is killed. Let's see, where, what is it? I can't find it. So, trying to find that one patient's name. Could not find it. She's supposed to be like a nymphomaniac. Maybe she is. At the same time, I kind of feel bad for her, especially with what happened. Landon finds out that Oliver Thredson is the real Bloody Face. Thredson tricks Kit into confessing, which of course means he's going to go to jail and be executed. Grace is about to be taken to be sterilized because they find out that the two of them were doing the do, and then gets abducted by aliens. She's brought back in a sort of like stasis, which is all really weird because Dr. Arden is like ready to like cut her open, and it just like flies across, and Pepper, who hasn't said a word, suddenly starts talking, which is so weird. The whole thing. Kit manages to escape, blackmails the Monsignor into letting them go, gets home, finds his wife is still alive, and has kids with both of these women. It's kind of cool, they live in sort of like this, hippie thing. The only problem is that Alma's not quite digging the hippie vibe. And she was not quite as thrilled with the abduction as Grace was. I think I said Alma. Grace. Alma does not quite dig the hippie vibe. And does not dig the alien invasion. Grace kind of views it as like a miracle, like they saved them. Lana manages to escape, to get everything on tape, and get it all taken care of, to where Thredson should be the one going to jail. In the end, she ends up shooting him. In his home, by the way, which is a very nice 60s... Oh god, what even do you call that? 60s minimalist techno astro lounge kind of look. I need to get that CD, by the way. on an unrelated note, I really need to get Smash Mouth's Astro Lounge. Used to have that CD, do not anymore. Gosh, so much is going on in this. It's so hard to talk about this season because there's so much going on. That it's... Because I guess, like, Thredson, like, either kidnaps or abducts or... somehow manages to get Lana and then locks her in his basement. He killed her girlfriend. Creeper. He gets her pregnant. He's got, like, some weird mommy fetish. Like, dude, taking an Oedipus complex to a whole nother level, and not one you should have gone to. It's just, it's wild, man. The whole thing. Sister Jude is kicked out of Briarcliff by Sister Mary Eunice and, Dr. Arden. She's committed to Briarcliff, like, she becomes a patient, and they basically fry her brain, which leads to quite possibly one of the most enjoyable scenes in any of the seasons, the name game. Lana Banna for Fana Banana Fana for... Yeah, that was a fun episode. just so much going on. The Monsignor, I believe it's the Monsignor, attempts to... to exorcise her or something, he ends up becoming possessed, and she ends up plummeting to the ground floor and dying. Dr. Arden, I believe, also is killed. I am not sure. There's just so much going on. Ugh. Well, that's right, he cremates himself. I have notes. But it's not always helpful. There's just so much going on in this. We find out later that Lana gave birth and that the child survived. And she gave him up for adoption. Which takes us right back to the very beginning. I say we start off with Kit Walker. We really start off with a couple who apparently thinks it's fun to go to supposedly haunted locations and get jiggy with it. I would tease them. I would make fun of them. Except that's probably... I mean, the getting jiggy with it part, not likely. That is so unsanitary. But going to potentially haunted places is totally up my alley. Anyway... they end up getting, like, attacked by these kids, who then are killed off by the real bloody face. Truthfully, they're killed off by Lana Winters and Oliver by the son of Lana Winters and Oliver Threadsome, who was given up for adoption, and who figured out who his mother was, and his father, because Lana just had to find out if he was okay, way back in, like, the late 70s. Kit Walker grew old. His kids grew up. He rescued Sister Jude from Briarcliff. It wasn't easy, but he did. And he sort of nursed her back to health. She helped raise his kids until she passed away. And his children grew up to be, I believe, what was it, an attorney and a doctor. He got cancer and then vanished without a trace. It's implied by the lighting and camera that he was abducted yet again. God only knows why. Maybe they thought he should live out the last of his days on a spaceship. I don't know. Maybe they had better technology and could save him, keep him alive forever. Apparently, these aliens seem to think that Kit Walker was something special. He is shown to be quite the hippie. That's nice. Kind of dig it myself. God, so much is going on in this season. It's insane. I mean... think about that for a minute. Demonic possession. Serial killer. Aliens. Death angel. Like, we actually get to see this person. This thing. Insane asylum. Creepy ex-Nazi doctors. The whole thing. There is so much going on in this season. It's... a little overwhelming, and I am grateful that they have not done something quite so convoluted in any of the seasons that I have watched since, because holy cow, that is a lot going on at one time, and it's hard to keep track of. Also, I'm still not sure how I felt about the Anne Frank cameo. According to American Horror Story Season 2, Anne Frank survived and came to America. And, well, actually, we're never actually sure if it really is Anne Frank or if it's just all in this woman's head. However, there is a really good chance that this is meant to actually be Anne Frank, given the fact that she's right about Arden being a creepy ex-Nazi. That supposedly is why she recognizes him when she's brought to the hospital, because he was basically like... they basically made Dr. Arden's character sort of like a Dr. Mengele, Joseph Mengele, the Angel of Death of Auschwitz, and his warped, really freaking warped medical experiments. Everything about that man pisses me off. Just say it. Just so. It's just crazy. Oh yeah, and Lana shoots her kid too. Like, just yeah. There's a lot going on. It's not bad. It really isn't. American Horror Story Season 2 is not a bad season. So far as I know, and keep in mind, I have not yet watched the 6th season, because it's not yet on Netflix. But as far as I know, none of the seasons of American Horror Story have been bad. But Asylum is just so much going on so quickly and so many things at the same time that it's a little hard to follow sometimes. And I spent a good 80% of the season sitting there going, they're not really aliens, right? There's not, like, really aliens, right? Yeah, no, there are. Oh, okay. Wow. I wasn't quite expecting that. The thing with Sister Mary Eunice. First of all, Lily Rabe is always amazing in these, and I love how she does characters who are, like, two things at once. In Murder House, she plays, I can't remember the name of the character. She plays the original owner of the house, who blew out her own brains. And she shifts wildly between being this largely competent, functional human being to being just obsessed with this, with where her kid is. Her kid who is downstairs. In season 2, she goes from being this sweet, innocent, demure little nun to being the devil himself. You know, and not like blood and guts and gore kind of devil, but just like that slick, slinky temptation. That evil for the sake of evil. There is something seriously underrated. People seriously under... It is seriously underappreciated. Characters who are evil just to be bad. Just for the sake of being evil. Like, they enjoy it. It brings them pleasure. That is so underappreciated in villains. We have to give our villains, like, these in-depth, complicated motives. It's like, you know, sometimes there isn't one. It doesn't always have to be like, oh, daddy didn't, mommy didn't love me, daddy didn't love me, I didn't get the attention I wanted as a child, or, you know, or the, I'm a terrible person, and I'm a, it doesn't have to be like these crazy, in-depth things. It can just be evil for the sake of being evil. You know? It's okay. It is okay to have a character who isn't like a crazy Joker from Batman type villain who's evil just because it's fun for them. They enjoy it. So, I absolutely loved Lily Rabe in that. She does so well at playing those kind of characters. In playing characters who are two things at once. It's really cool. Evan Peters is always a joy. Always. Sarah Paulson is amazing. Her character, Lana, is like stone cold, man. It's just stone cold. And Jessica Langley's character of Sister Jude. Okay, first of all, she is definitely the queen of American Horror Story. I am so sad that she left after season four. She was glorious. She does really well at playing characters who are conflicted, who are confident, but who have their hidden pains, who have these things in their past that hurt them, or these things in their future that hurt them. You know, in season one, she plays Tate's mother. She's a woman who is arrogant enough to have always been focused on herself, but who at the same time was always mistreated as well. So she's always focused on her needs and her wants, but it's kind of because nobody around her is. You know, I mean, like she gets married to this guy and then finds him screwing the maid, which basically is like downhill from there. You know, in Asylum, she was a nightclub singer who I believe was married and in a very unhappy relationship or something like that, and was constantly sleeping around, and then accidentally hit a little girl, and just freaks out, ends up giving up alcohol, and becoming a nun. Briarcliff is kind of her penance, if you will. And as this progresses, you get to find that she is tormented by this. That, you know, she finds out that the little girl survived, with just some broken bones. And she's grateful for that. You find that there's a lot going on in her past. That kind of is a burden to her. Which works really well for her character. So, overall, I would give Asylum probably a 7.5 to 8 out of 10. It's not my favorite season of American Horror Story, but it's also not my least favorite. We'll get to that one next. I just felt like there was too much going on in season two. There's so many different things going on, so many different things, and it's really hard to keep it all straight in your head. I mean, that's just my perspective on it. So anyway, like, comment, leave me a review, leave me suggestions. I'm on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook as Stars and Galaxies, STARSNDGALAXIES. I'm on Tumblr as Wednesday's Child's Witchcraft, and drop me a line. Say hi. Night, Grimlings. Pleasant nightmares.